I really enjoyed this debate that you're about to watch. This is Tucker Carlson versus Cornel West on the issue of democratic socialism.
You've heard the phrase a lot lately, democratic socialist. It's suddenly very common on the left. Bernie Sanders has called himself a democratic socialist. So has New York congressional candidate Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez. She's the woman that the DNC chair, Tom Perez, recently said this about.
She represents the future of our party. Alexandria's victory was just a remarkable reminder of the depth that we have in the Democratic Party.
Okay, so democratic socialism is the future, but what is democratic socialism? We thought it'd be worth pausing for a minute to find out. Democratic socialism is not, by the way, a wing of the Democratic Party, at least not yet. It's an entirely separate movement with its own national organization, the Democratic Socialists of America. 2 years ago, the DSA endorsed Bernie Sanders and opposed Donald Trump, but did not endorse Hillary Clinton. So at times, it has been antagonistic to the Democratic Party. What did democratic socialists believe? There's no formal platform, but the outlines are pretty clear. Democratic socialists support socialism, state ownership of major industries. That would include healthcare, technology, manufacturing. Some of them explicitly support communism. The co-chair of Portland, Oregon's chapter of the DSA recently tweeted this, quote, "As a DSA chapter co-chair, I just want to set the record straight for a minute. Communism is good." But democratic socialism is about more than economics. The DSA's official Twitter account demands reparations for African Americans in the form of free and open enrollment at public colleges, retroactive forgiveness of student loans, and a guaranteed lifetime minimum income. The DSA has also called for an end to all immigrant deportations everywhere in the United States. In New York, the DSA has demanded the abolition of profits, prisons, cash bail, and borders. Not all democratic socialists have the same views on everything, but that gives you some idea. Unlimited, uncontrolled immigration into the U.S., coupled with race-based reparations, the abolition of prisons, and by extension, law and order itself, and a massive expansion of the welfare state financed by an economic system that does not recognize profit. How would that work exactly? Has it ever worked in any country in the world? Those suddenly seem like relevant questions. At this pace, a democratic socialist could get the Democratic nomination at some point and be elected president. So we thought it was a perfect moment to speak to possibly the most famous of all advocates for democratic socialism, Cornel West. He's a professor at Harvard. He's an honorary co-chair of the Democratic Socialists of America, and he joins us tonight. Cornel, thank you for coming on.
No, thank you, and it's good to be in dialogue with you once again, though, brother.
Yes, it is. So to give us some sense of what democratic socialism is, can you point to an example, an extant example of it that works? Venezuela seems like an example of democratic socialism. Would you say that it is? And if so, does it work?
No, I don't think that democratic socialism as an ideal has been able to be embodied in a larger social context. There's different forms of it. Some are bad, some are medium, some are better. But the fundamental commitment is to the dignity of ordinary people and to make sure they can live lives of decency. So it's not an ism, no, brother. It's about decency. It's about fairness.
Right.
It's about the accountability of the powerful vis-a-vis those who have less power. The workplace, women dealing with the household, gays, lesbians, trans, black people, indigenous peoples, immigrants. How do we ensure that they are treated decently and that the powerful don't in any way manipulate, subjugate, and exploit them?
Well, I mean, if that's what democratic socialism is, then I'm basically on board. I do think that ordinary people, middle-class people, ought to have
Absolutely.
Dignity. And I think that our current systems make it hard for them to have dignity. So I agree
Absolutely.
With all of that. But the details
and
matter.
And that's precisely why, that's why Albert Einstein, Helen Keller, Norman Thomas, Eugene Debs, Martin Luther King Jr., Ella Baker, we can go on and on. They're all democratic socialists. Michael Harrington, one of the great founders of Democratic Socialists of America. I've been a member for 36 years.
I understand, but has it struck you as interesting that it's never actually worked anywhere? So the question is not what are our goals. Our goals are the same. How do we get there is the question. So what happened in Venezuela? They call that democratic socialism, but they don't have toilet paper, and it's less equal than ever.
But part of the problem is, though, brothers, that any time there's been the attempts of ordinary people to engage in self-determination, they can get crushed by external nations. Look at U.S. policies toward Venezuela has been very, very ugly. Nicaragua in the same way. We saw that in so many other instances where countries try to engage in self-determination and they either get crushed, they either get coerced, and they end up oftentimes responding to that kind of authoritarian treatment. So we've never had a chance to really pull it off. So it's only been a movement so far. It's an attempt to resist the greed at the top, the racism, the sexism, the homophobia, the various ways in which humanity is violated rather than affirmed.
So here's just to the details quickly. The DSA of New York, which is certainly one of the biggest in the country, recently
said... And thank God for Sister Alexandria. She's my dear sister and comrade.
So they said that they're against borders, profits, and prisons. What would a country without prisons look like? What would you do with murderers, for example, or rapists? Where would you put them with no prisons?
Well, I mean, when they say prisons, they're talking about the kinds of prisons we have at the present. If you have sites of rehabilitation, education, ways in which transformation can take place, you and I ourselves, and you're Episcopalian, I'm Baptist, we're Christians, right? We believe all human beings made not just an image of God, but they can be changed, they can be transformed when the right kind of intervention takes place. That's what people mean in the socialist movement when they talk about the elimination of the kind of prisons that are in place.
So what they really mean is better
murderers
prisons.
And rapists
Maybe they should
and others.
Be more... Okay, so what about borders, though?
You can have isolation, you can have distance, but you don't give up on them. And most importantly, you don't view them in the vicious through the lens of being less than human, that they can bounce back, they can be better.
So if a government's obligation is to its own citizens, and you drop the borders and have no border enforcement at all, what would happen to this country? What would happen to the poor people in this country? Would their lives get better? Would they become more prosperous? No. This country would become poorer, dirtier, impossible to manage. It would be flooded with the poor of the world, and it would destroy our country instantly. So why would you say no borders?
Well, I mean, again, though, you got a variety of voices in the Democratic Socialists of America. We like a jazz orchestra. You got different perspectives and orientations. We all don't agree on one particular policy all the time. This is true in terms of Israeli occupation of Palestinians. Some are in the middle, some are much more critical, like myself. The question is, how do you keep track of the rich humanity of Mexican brothers and sisters, of those coming from Latin America, those coming from Africa, those coming from Haiti, and those coming from Europe and Asia? That's the important thing. We know the history of America, other than indigenous peoples and Africans who've been enslaved, was to open the borders, to bring folk in, to allow people to gain access. But it's not a matter of no borders at all. It's a matter of how do you ensure that their dignity is affirmed when they arrive so that you don't end up having the kind of neo-fascist policies of the Trump administration separating these precious children from their mothers and fathers.
That's silly, as you well know.
Okay, so I have a lot to say about this. That back and forth was interesting. I'm a fan of Cornel West. I don't think he did a great job there. I think I'd grade him like a C, maybe a C+. Listen, here's the deal. Democratic socialism now has multiple meanings, as I described in a segment recently called Democratic Socialism versus Social Democracy. Whether or not we want to acknowledge it, the reality is you have actual democratic socialists who describe themselves as democratic socialists. So that's people who believe in social ownership of the means of production. That is a post-capitalist philosophy. So you have those people describing themselves as democratic socialists, but you also have Bernie Sanders, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, TYT, and others describing themselves as democratic socialists. Now, literally and technically, Bernie Sanders, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, TYT, and many others who describe themselves as democratic socialists, they're not democratic socialists. They're social democrats. So they don't believe in a total post-capitalist philosophy. They believe in welfare statism. They believe in a system that keeps some aspects of capitalism, but also nationalizes certain industries. So healthcare, for example, it expands and gives us free college. You get rid of all the student loan debt, you wipe that debt slate clean, you do better regulation of the marketplace, like Wall Street. So now democratic socialism, again, whether or not we want to acknowledge it, I know some of you may, you know, look at the what's happened with this definition and be upset by it, and that's fine. I was upset by it for a very long time. But whether or not we want to acknowledge it, that's what's now happening. There are some democratic socialists who are actual democratic socialists, but now social democrats also describe themselves as democratic socialists. So when Tucker Carlson says at the beginning, what is democratic socialism? And then he says, well, it's socialism, or it's even communism. We need to challenge that head on and say, for some people, democratic socialism is socialism. For others, it is not. It is social democracy. It is still keeping some aspects of the capitalist system in place while making basic reforms to meet the bare necessities of life and provide equal opportunity. Now, I know that's perhaps too wordy of a way to describe it, but we can boil that down and we can make it shorter and more punchy. But bottom line is, we need to not allow the opposition to define what we are, especially when they're inaccurately defining what we are. Now, you could say he's half correct in his explanation, but in today's day and age, his definition is certainly not an all-encompassing, totally accurate definition. Because many people who describe themselves as democratic socialists, perhaps Bernie Sanders being the most prominent, does not believe in a post-capitalist philosophy. And to imply that he does is just massively disingenuous. So I don't know if he's doing it on purpose or not, but it ends up being massively disingenuous because so many people now describe themselves as democratic socialists and they don't believe in a post-capitalist philosophy. Now, here's the part where Cornel West, I think, falls short. When Tucker Carlson lays out, hey, here's some of the things like the New York City DSA account tweeted, oh, you know, we're in favor of reparations, we want to end all deportations, we want to end profit, prison, borders. Cornel West pushes back a little bit, but not nearly enough for my liking. Because here's the deal. Even if you're somebody who believes in those policies, you're not going to win that debate. You're not going to win that debate. It's not happening. You're not going to convince a majority of Americans that reparations is the way to go. Again, whether or not you agree with it, you're not going to convince them that ending all deportations is the way to go. You're not going to win that debate. You're just not. And if you think you are, you're fucking dead wrong. You're dead wrong. You're not going to win the debate about totally ending profit, ending prisons, not just private prisons. You'll win that debate, and I'll lead on that debate. But you're not going to win that debate about ending prisons, and you're not going to win the debate about ending borders. So, my whole thing is, and I'm biased, because I have my own philosophy that I'm advocating for, which leans more towards social democracy than actual democratic socialism. But, since you're not going to win those debates, why would you put that foot forward? It just strikes me as, like, those are not things where we should circle the wagons and go, yes, Tucker, you're right. Everybody who describes themselves as a democratic socialist wants to ban profit and all prisons and all borders. Because then he wins. He wins, the right wins, and that's it. Because you're never gonna convince people that those are majority popular opinions because they're not. And by the way, those are opinions I happen to disagree with, full disclosure. I don't want to end profit. I don't want to end all prisons. I don't want to end borders. And even if you fire back, like I saw last time I mentioned this, some people were like, oh, what a lazy take you're doing, Kyle. I'm not a dumb person. When I read end prisons and somebody tells me that, no, it doesn't mean what it says it means. Hey, fuck you, man. Then get your messaging right, bitch. That's not on me. That's not on me. And if I don't understand it, you really think somebody who you're trying to win over as a voter in a goddamn Oklahoma is gonna get it? Fuck off! Fuck off! This terrible messaging. So, what I would do is directly push back on Tucker. When he says, oh, what is democratic socialism? It's socialism! It's even communism! No, your response to that is, it's not communism. For some people, it's a post-capitalist philosophy, socialism. But for in today's day and age, for many people, it is not a post-capitalist philosophy. Democratic socialism is used interchangeably with social democracy. So the first thing I do is question his premise, because his premise is wrong. It's not just socialism. That's the first thing I do is say, no, you're wrong on your premise, and let me explain. And if he doesn't accept that reframing of it, then he's wrong, because it's just factually accurate to say many people now use the term democratic socialist when they mean social democracy. The other thing I do is, the second he tries to take the fringe examples of people in the DSA, and maybe they're not fringe in the actual DSA, to be fair, but I think it's fringe among people who would describe themselves as democratic socialists. That's an important point. Second, he brings up those policies. Hey, look at these guys, man. They all want reparations. They all want to end all deportations. They all want to end profit. They all want to end prisons and borders. If I'm Cornel West, and he did an okay job here, and there's one point where he's like, no, not everybody agrees to ending borders. I would have been stronger. I would have said, no, most people who describe themselves as democratic socialists don't want to end profit, don't want to end prisons, don't want to end borders. Now again, within the organization DSA, what I'm saying there could be wrong. But among people who describe themselves as democratic socialists, I'm certainly correct. Most people who describe themselves as democratic socialists would not agree with those positions. So, directly push back on that, man. And then, see, the thing is, we're on issues where it's mixed, point out it's mixed. Point out it's mixed. But on the issues where virtually everybody who describes themselves as a democratic socialist agrees, that's where you really put the pedal to the metal. So, what I focus on overwhelmingly is we all want a Medicare for all system, and guess what? Over 60% of the American people want a Medicare for all system. We all want free college. Guess what? 58% of the American people want free college. We all want to legalize marijuana and end the drug war. Guess what? Over 60% of the American people want to legalize marijuana. Guess what? We all want to end the wars, the offensive wars of aggression in Afghanistan and Iraq, and stop bombing the 8 countries we're currently bombing. Guess what? Only 17% of Americans still want to be in Afghanistan, and that poll was done all the way back in 2013. It's probably even lower today. So, you take the issues where we win and we already have everybody with us, and you say, hey, those other policies that are a little kooky that you brought up, that's very mixed within the DSA. Here are the issues where everybody who describes himself as a democratic socialist agrees, and this is what we're really about. Medicare for all, free college, living wage, ending the wars, legalizing marijuana, New Deal, ending the drug war, taxing Wall Street. Because you bring those up and everybody goes, yeah, that's right, I like that, I'm with you on that. But what Tucker's doing here in a very clever way is he's taking the worst policies advocated by some people who are democratic socialists and saying, ah, here they are, this is the movement, and isn't it just like communism? And then he says, can you point to an example that works in the world? And then of course he brings up Venezuela, because there's no way any right-winger will ever bring up these ideas and philosophies without either bringing up Venezuela, Cuba, or the Soviet Union. It's a fucking law of nature. It's like gravity. Somebody, if you bring that up, if a right-winger brings up socialism or democratic socialism, they immediately, Venezuela, Cuba, Soviet Union. Bad. Poop face. So, and this is why I give Cornel West more like a C grade, even though I'm a big fan of his. Because, no, you immediately have to answer that question with Scandinavia. Now, I know, there are people who are hardcore democratic socialists believing in the post-capitalist version of democratic socialism, and they don't like that example. Too bad for you. And it also sucks for you that today, many people who describe themselves as democratic socialists believe in social democracy. But that is the nature of reality today. The second Bernie Sanders described himself as a democratic socialist when he's a run-of-the-mill social democrat, that cat was out of the bag and there was no going back in. you know, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, standard social democrat, she describes herself as a democratic socialist. She literally advocated for small business tax cuts the other day, okay? So, this idea that, like, oh, she wants to move past capitalism, totally, but fucking bullshit. Absolute bullshit. So, can you point to an example that works? Yeah, Scandinavia. Scandinavia. Norway, Denmark, Iceland, Sweden. There, it works great. And in fact, you look at the objective measures of how those countries are doing versus how we're doing, they kick our ass. They kick our ass. Probably the most important metric is self-reported happiness, where you ask them, hey, how do you like life? People go, I fucking love it. You know, they don't have medical bills. They don't have people dying because they don't have access to healthcare. They get like a month paid vacation by law. So it turns out when you give people a little more vacation time, when you give them quality of life, when you give them a decent wage, when you give them free healthcare and education, turns out people go, hey, you know what? This is sweet. I like this. So when he asks that question, you can't respond with, no, see, we never actually had it implemented in any way. Because actually, the reason why I lean towards social democracy, I have some ideas that are post social democracy and going into the realm of democratic socialism, to be fair. But the reason why I lean mostly towards social democracy is very simple. Empiricism. I look around the world, I go, hey, what's working the best? And I see what the fuck is working the best. And I go, that seems like they got it more correct than anybody else around the world. And that's almost axiomatically true, because when you look at the measurements, they are doing better than everywhere else around the world. So, Cornel, you can't answer that question like that. You can't say, well, it's a movement and there hasn't been a place, because you know what that sounds like? That sounds like those idiot libertarians who are like, hey man, libertarianism has never worked anywhere, ever. And they're like, well, yeah, we haven't had perfect libertarianism implemented anywhere. Or when even when you bring it up to communists, like, hey man, communism, I'm not sure that works. Can you point to an example? They go, well, we haven't really had a perfect example, because every time they try to implement it, they don't do it the right way. And that always comes across as a bullshit response, no matter what philosophy or ideology is trying to explain it away. Because it always sounds like excuse making. It's always like, oh, yeah, see, you don't have an answer, and you don't have an answer because you're wrong, and your philosophy is dumb. But if you have an answer right there, ready to go, Scandinavia, Norway, Denmark, Iceland, Sweden, the Nordic states, then what the fuck is Tucker Carlson gonna say? Well, I don't think that's the first. I mean, I guarantee you, I can almost guarantee you, what would his immediate reaction be? The worst dodge ever, which makes him look like the asshole that he is, where they go, yeah, well, those places are homogeneous. That's another way of saying, well, they're really white, so you can get away with doing policies that are rational. What? Why wouldn't you be able to do those wonderful policies in places that have mixes of all different races and backgrounds and ethnicities? Of course you could do that. In fact, Canada is to the left of us on the spectrum, and Canada is very diverse. They have a wonderful universal healthcare system there, and they also have diversity. So it's not like it needs to be all white in order to do rational policies that have nothing to do with race. So, yeah, I don't know. I really enjoyed this back and forth. I really enjoyed this discussion, but it does kind of annoy me because I think that it's one of those issues where Cornel West and Democratic Socialists and Social Democrats can have a flawless victory, but instead of having a Mortal Kombat flawless victory, people come out of it going, 50-50. Or if anything, many people, because people who watch this are usually right-wing, because it's Tucker Carlson, they're already leaning in his direction, and then certainly, given the defense he puts up, people will go, yeah, I agree with Tucker. Look at all these crazy Democratic Socialists, and they all want reparations, they want to end all deportations, and they all want to end profit, and they all want to end prisons, and they all want to end borders. And by the way, guys, this is one of the really important reasons why I think you need strong leadership on the left. Because winning is not simply a matter of just going as far left as possible. Winning is a matter of going populist left. There's a difference there. As far left as possible and populist left are not the same thing. So populist left means exactly what's in the fucking title. Go to the issues, look at that which is massively popular already. Those are your core issues. Those are the things you don't shut the fuck up about and you don't let your enemy off the hook about. Your opposition, I should say, not your enemy. So, and that's again why I bring it up all the time. Economically populist, Medicare for all, free college, living wage, end the wars, New Deal, and then even some social issues, legalized marijuana. And these are things that it's not only because some people will strawman my philosophy here and go, oh, but the problem is you're not focusing on justice for like gender justice or racial justice. And that's just simply not true, because, for example, when you talk about ending the drug war and legalizing marijuana and releasing all the nonviolent drug offenders from prison, which is something I would absolutely run on, what happens in that situation? Well, it's a matter of fact that the drug war is disproportionately used against minority communities. We've gone over the statistics 1,000 times over. Black people and white people use drugs at a similar rate. Black people are 4 times more likely to get arrested for using drugs. White people sell drugs way more than black people. Black people way more likely to get arrested for selling drugs. So there are real racial disparities there. So if you end the drug war and legalize marijuana, you get racial justice! So the key is, you have to focus on the universal issues, though, that appeal to everybody, because that's how you win. So you don't need to pander and be pedantic and condescending. You don't need to say, I'm only going to talk about black issues in order to get the black vote, because then in the process of only talking about black issues, what do? You alienate everybody who's white who may be with you. And it works the other way, too. You don't only focus on white working class voters. You have to have a universal message that appeals to everybody, which is why the answer to win elections is populist left, because you get justice for everybody. At the same time, you advocate for policies that are overwhelmingly popular already. It turns out the American people are not stupid. They might not be educated on history very well. So they might be ignorant of facts about the world. And I think that's true. It's a scary percentage of people that, you know, can't name any Supreme Court justice or don't know the vice president. So yes, that's ignorance. You could say that's ignorance. But here's what the American people aren't. Stupid. They're not fucking masochists who are like, you know, I'm gonna vote for policies that will fuck over my life more, man! That's not a thing! I mean, maybe with a tiny 20-25% of the country, maybe, is in that boat. But that means there's so many more people who are like, yeah, I'm in favor of things that would help me in my life and the country. So, yeah, that's why you focus on the populist left issues. Here's what's not a populist issue. Ending profit. Ending borders. Ending prisons. That's not populist. So, don't let the right redefine it. I'm already seeing it. It's not just Tucker, it's many others. They redefine it, and what they're doing is, they're saying, no, Democratic Socialists are all post-capitalist. You know that's not true, because Bernie Sanders is a social democrat and describes himself as a democratic socialist. Almost everybody, when asked nowadays, oh, you're a democratic socialist, what does that mean to you? Virtually none of them say, I believe in a post-capitalist philosophy. They don't say that. You know, and Democratic Socialists of America, for people who would argue, well, Democratic Socialists of America backed Alexandria, therefore she's a democratic socialist in the old school sense of being post-capitalist. Well, Democratic Socialists of America also backed Bernie Sanders. And Bernie Sanders is certainly not post-capitalist. He described that a zillion times. And Alexandria herself, like I just told you, the other day she was tweeting about how she's in favor of small business tax cuts. Is that post-capitalist? No, not by any stretch of the imagination. So don't let your opposition define you. You have to be accurate about these things. Yes, some democratic socialists are post-capitalist. Turns out, most people who would describe themselves that way nowadays believe in social democracy. So, because this is what happens. If you let your opponent define you, then what they're going to do is, what Tucker's going to do is, he is going to make you defend the worst aspects of the fringiest elements of democratic socialism. And then if you fall into that trap and defend them, you immediately lose. Because then you've said, oh, your characterization of me was accurate. It was accurate. And that's the last thing that you should do. So, I mean, don't get me wrong, Cornel West is brilliant. I love Cornel West. I think he's a really smart person. And I've done many segments about him before, and it's been almost universal praise. But this is the first time that I'm going, okay, no, do you get like maybe a C or C plus in your response here? You held your own, but I don't think it was a great appearance. I think we need to really head on address some of the points he's making so that we're clear. So everybody understands, and so that it's not like democratic socialism immediately gets, shoved to the side at this ascendant moment where people go, there's a reason why they were on the fringes, see? So anyway, that's my take on it. This is a very long segment, so I'll stop talking now.